Well, you're welcome back. You're welcome back. And of course, my baby is here.
Good morning.
Whilst you guys.
How are you?
Morning, I'm good. You guys, we're reading the news and everything. Have you guys checked Twitter today?
What's happening?
No. Ooh. Beyonce Shatawale already. It is trending, eh?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You mean the song, the audio is out?
Of course, it is. Do you want to listen?
Yeah, we're going to search
what
for it.
What do you mean we're going to search? Fred, drop the thing.
But there's
laser, major laser on this one.
Yeah. Is that an American artist?
Yeah.
Is it American? He's a sort of a producer. DJ.
Oh.
Oh!
Why is it there?
So you love it? I absolutely love it. That's brilliant.
I do too.
Love at first sound.
It is a great banger.
Oh wow.
And this is a bit different from your normal Quimby kind of sound.
Yeah.
She's sounding
more
like
Afro-pop.
Yeah.
Which was the intention, you know.
For the album.
She said in an interview that she decided that she wanted the album to be African.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah, well, she's succeeded, hasn't
yeah.
she?
Yeah, and I heard Shatawale said on a radio station that Beyonce, everything that he did, Beyonce just loved it. So when he sent the work, she said, I love everything. Yeah. I like it the way you did it. Yeah. So.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Oh, it's a big one for Shatawale and all the Shata movement. Yo, you are part of the movement.
Yeah.
Okay. Now you are.
He's always been. Hey.
Shut up.
Yeah.
You live in Ashaiman and you are part of the Shatta movement.
Oh, but right now they are friends, so.
And they're best friends. I still love Stoneboy. Yeah.
Me, bim.
Is that so?
That's more.
Yeah, he has a new one. Is it?
Why do you have to be part of one and not the other? Can't you like?
Yeah, so I like
them both.
So for me, it's Stoneboy.
Tough seat. That was pretty good.
Sack, of course, Manifests.
Yeah.
Yo. But I appreciate it.
I think I appreciate it
when Shatta does something like what he's done. I mean, I've been praising him.
But
I'm not part of the movement. I don't claim to be part of the movement because today Beyonce featured him. You get what I mean? Yeah.
I like the song. That's all I have to
Bim
say about
for
it.
Life.
I mean, the song is brilliant. It's brilliant. Yeah. And it's pure Shatta, you know?
Let's do homegrown news, eh?
Okay, so I have the Finder, the Daily Graphic, and the Daily Guide. What have you got?
I've got the publisher, Go Street Business, BNFT, and then I have got the Ghanaian Observer.
I'll do the Ghanaian Times, the Daily Statesman, and the Daily Dispatch newspaper. Where shall we begin, guys?
I can get started. Should we do like all the headlines and then we settle for the stories afterwards? Okay, I'll start with the Daily Guide, then I'll do Graphic and Finder. So Daily Guide, banner headline this morning, 12 trapped in Galamsey pit. Picture of that, plus a picture of the body that was retrieved after the rescue efforts. IMF stings Mahama on free fall spending. Another policeman joins NDC race, and Asawase NDC tension escalates. Let's flip that over. On the back page, we have four stories. Drop losing black stars for I'm winning yells. GTF postpones Taekwondo championship. CAF sacks first Veep, And Fist of Fury gets Goyle support. That's it for the Daily Guide. Daily Graphic next. Ajay refutes architect's allegation, says firm is doing legitimate business. Collapsing mine kills one, injures another. And first district scholarship scheme launched in Second D. And the banner headline in the Daily Graphic this morning, low fish catch. Hey, close season here, kwaya na yebe. Sellers turn to cold stores. That's the banner headline. Back page, history beckons Senegal and Algeria. And Sani Dara named media officer for AFCON final. Okay, so
for
that's
the
Daily
one
Graphic.
Single game, a media officer for the one final game.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
We
not
playing.
Sure I had that before, but yeah, that's cool. Well,
you know.
Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah, it's cool. Okay. It's a job.
I'll take your word for
you
it.
You get paid for it.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hopefully, unless he's
it's legit
doing it
job
as charity or whatever. Okay, The Finder is next. And banner headline this morning, TUC backs ADB-NIB restructuring. Calls for salary increases for public sector workers. Okay, no surprise there. Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire lift suspension on 2020-21 cocoa sales. Government to implement plan of action for journalist safety. And 82% of LPG stations in central region identified as high risk. And that does it. For the final, that is for me.
Okay, let me continue with the Ghanaian Times newspaper. I'll follow that up with the Daily Dispatch and end it with the Daily Statesman. So here we go with the Ghanaian Times front page. Scotus evicted from Shaibu slums at Dansuman. JEA males lecture held in Accra. Ghana Cote d'Ivoire lift suspension on 2020-2021 cocoa sale. The banner headline though, TUC cautions government. Ensure Ghana never returns to IMF program. Comes with a picture of Yaba, who is the TUC boss. Center spread, translate SDGs into prudent policies for excellent service delivery. That's a call by the chief of staff. Details of the front page headlines in the center spread. And on the back page, Mani Marais takes center stage tonight as Senegal-Algeria battle for AFCON glory. And there's a Cameroonian referee who will be in the center of this game tonight. The Daily Dispatch, Iyoko to probe award of National Cathedral and the $200 million second chamber. 82% of LPG stations in central region are high risk, according to the NPA. Some pastors are only good boasting about their expensive cars. That's according to Bishop Charles Ajinasari. Details of that in the paper today. And the Daily Statesman newspaper. Marketers group voices fear over plans to double LPG use. IMF praises NPP positive change and indicts Mahama. Scholarships at your doorstep. Government releases 30 million Ghana cedis for local tertiary education support by way of what is on the front page of the Daily Statesman today when you grab it. Yeah, I'm done.
Okay, so let me do the rest. I have four of them. The new publisher is what we start with. Church woman killed in Volta region. KMA not chasing media with soldiers. Mayor. The main story on the front page of the new publisher. Nana's boys to resign as they chase MP job. Another NDC policeman quits to contest Dangote on page 6 of the paper. Over 19,000 Ghanaians get HIV in 1 year. We also have the Ghanaian Observer. Ghanaian Observer, NDC locks out Muntaka contenders. Chaos in Ashanti NDC deepens. Also on the front page of the Ghanaian Observer, Minister foils traders. KMA showdown, and this is a story on the front page of the Ghanaian Observer. But let's go to the Gold Street business. Public debt further rises to 200 billion Ghana cedis. The Gold Street business. On the other stories occupying the front page, private sector still crowded out of bank credit. despite recapitalization. Ghana globally competitive in SME financing by banks. They also have the exchange rate update for you and how the other currencies are performing also on the front page. On the back page, Yolanda Cuba, that's the back page of the Gold Street business. Yolanda Cuba joins MTN as Group Chief of Digital and FinTech.
And then she used to be with Vodafone?
CEO. Okay. Yeah, Ghana. Yeah. Star Life CEO among female leaders in African insurance industry. Yeah. There's a picture there of Kakra before Nyako. We'll do the last paper. The BNFT has on the front page budget overrun likely. EIU wants. Predict 5.5% end year deficit. And then we also have GIHOC set to upset, or GIHOC to set up fruit-based alcohol plants to produce wines, alcoholic drinks. Reduce taxes on LPG to increase usage, according to the LPG Association. And ENI UNIDO signed joint declaration to accelerate sustainable development goals. Back page of the BNFT, adopt entrepreneurial mindset, PR practitioners told. As an inserted picture of the group head communications for the Just Bond Group, Sophia Lisa. Also, with all the stories for the day for me.
All right, any particular one you guys want to touch on?
Start.
I have one.
Cool.
Yeah?
Yeah, let's go with it.
Low fish catch.
Ah.
Sellers turn to cold stores. So, I mean, you guys remember
we talked
so much about the close season and the fact that it was being done at the wrong time for spawning of the fish. Well, they finished the close season and the fishermen are not finding fish, according to the Daily Graphic. They went out.
I hope they're not complaining.
Who? The fishermen.
The fishermen. Well, they were even divided on this, weren't they?
Yes, but more in fact, you're right. Some of them wanted the close season to be done at the right time, mm-hmm. as the scientists had recommended.
Because I remember there was statement that was issued.
Yeah, but the majority of them were siding with the ministry that they wanted to do it in April.
I thought this was my understanding. Mm. The majority of them were saying they wanted the April time and the ministry went with them.
That's it.
I thought that was it.
That's actually it. Mm. So,
does it mean that the ministry then initially proposed what the scientists, like your dad?
I mean, the professionals came with the right dates.
The scientists made a proposal to the ministry. Mm. In the end, the ministry announced a close season of April, which was not what the scientists proposed.
Because they were saying it should
because they said the fishermen didn't want to do it in September. Mm. So they wanted to work with the fishermen. And so they decided to do it in April. Mm. So they finished it, and there's no fish.
We've closed and opened.
This is where we are.
Yes. Mm. So now here's what's happening. According to the journalist who did this story, he's been going to different beaches, and the fishermen are not even bothering to go out to sea anymore, because when they spend money on pre-mixed fuel and they go out there and they get nothing, it's a waste. So essentially, the fishing profession is dying. Okay, this is what the fishermen didn't seem to get.
They want us.
They didn't seem to get what they were doing to themselves.
Mm. I don't blame them. Well, I blame the authority.
You see, that's the thing, because that's the point of an authority. Mm-hmm. You should know better. Your child comes to you and says, "Me, I want toffees for dinner." And you say, okay, I'm going to work with the child. Mm-hmm. Because if I tell the child to eat healthily, they won't be happy.
But does it also give us an indication that perhaps the ministry, because of maybe the political capital that it could get siding with the fishermen, then went ahead. But then it will mean that the minister heading the ministry was not assertive enough to say that, look, scientifically, this is what could work. And so I want to side with scientists and rather do a proper communication activity or an engagement to convince them why they should. Because the ministry then would have failed in
the engagement had already been done. The scientists themselves
had
spoke to the fishermen.
And they had agreed.
Well, the fish, I'll tell you what. Even after the ministry announced the April close season, some scientists engaged with the fishermen. And when the fishermen heard the scientists' explanation with presentations and everything, they said, oh, if we had understood it this way, mm-hmm. we wouldn't have pushed for April. But they still didn't change their minds. They still didn't go back to the ministry and say, look, let's do September because the scientists have explained to us. No, they still went ahead with April. So really, they deserve what they get. It's a pity. I like fish. So I'm going to lose out because I can't get fish to buy.
Well, you'll get fish to buy, but only at a high cost. There's a demand
exactly. And it will be frozen fish imported from some place. Exactly. You know, so I lose out. But as for them, all the... look, now what is the argument? There's no fish. So now, what political capital has the ministry gained, if that is what they were going for? Where is the political capital? If all fishermen find themselves out of work, what do you gain?
Who would you blame? Is it the fishermen on one side or the ministry?
The ministry.
Yeah.
I blame the ministry entirely. Because look, the fishermen, they work with tradition, long-standing beliefs, and so forth. So as far as they are aware, this is how it's done, okay? But you see, you just have to be a little logical to realize that their traditions are what have led us here. At this point...
Because then there's been overfishing.
Yes, they've been doing things their way all this time, and as a result, there's no fish. So if they come and say, do it my way, and you too, you say, okay, what name should we call you?
Well, who should know better? It's not on the one side.
The ministry.
It's obvious for a liar.
The ministry.
It's obvious.
So it's the ministry that didn't do it when they didn't engage with. I think I side with you.
Page 3 of the Ghanaian Times. Well, two stories of interest for me away from the close opening now, no fish. I went to Choco. I was doing a story with Jojo coming up. We went to Choco and I realized the women smoking the fish. Eh? Mm-hmm. They're actually frozen, like they buy mm-hmm. from the cold store.
Yeah.
The salmon we buy That's on right. the market. Yeah.
That's exactly thought, what the story
so,
is saying.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So it's Charlie.
So you're saying
price has gone up. That.
So okay, so you're saying that the fishmongers are smoking imported fish.
Yes.
Yeah, frozen fish.
No more
from
Jamestown or somewhere.
No, no. I saw the boxes, like they are there.
There's no fish in Jamestown. The Jamestown fishermen can't catch fish because they did close season in April.
So the Jamestown fishermen, their plight is here.
So the point is that this is an issue. It's a big challenge that we have. We're just trying to resolve it. And the recommendations are not being followed. So we're just backtracking.
How long do we have?
Let's do the story on page 3 in the Ghanaian Times newspaper. Oh, time is up. Okay. Mm.
No, I don't mean time is up for us. He was asking how long do we have to turn around the situation.
No, yeah, I agree with you. Time is it's worsened already. If we can't simply follow the recommendations that professionals give, then we'll forever be here.
That's very
we'll get
sad.
Worse.
So guess what they're going to, for just a quick one, guess what they're going to do in September? They're going to have a closed season for the trawlers. The ones who are supposed to be doing deep sea fishing. They are not supposed to be fishing in the area where we are doing the closed season. But they are doing closed season for them in September. So they are acknowledging that those guys are fishing where they shouldn't be fishing. But instead of enforcing it, you are doing closed season for them. It's kind of like saying, I'm robbers. For September, don't rob. And then you can resume in October.
Let's do the Ghanaian Times. There is a sad. I'm laughing, but this is really sad. I mean, it's. Let's do page 3 of the Ghanaian Times newspaper. Obinim sues GRA for freezing his account. Fidelity details of that. He's asking the court for a number of things. So first of all, the GRA froze the accounts of Bishop Obinim with a Fidelity Bank for not paying tax on a 21-unit shop operated at Abroso Guest House at Tema. The plaintiff in this case, Obinim, said that the guest house was a separate entity and not under the direct control of Bishop Obinim, adding that he had paid all outstanding rent taxes to the GRA and receipts were issued. So it's I'm sure you've spotted the story somewhere on social media. It's one that's been developing for a while now. It goes back to the GRA on December 18, writing to Obinim demanding payment of alleged tax liability of 719,890 Ghana cedis. And then in a response, the plaintiff stated that the Economic and Organized Crime Office conducted audits and assessment on the property for the period spanning 2014 to 2018 and concluded that plaintiff's tax liability was 39,555, so well below what the GRA had stated. So you can read a lot more of the details in the paper today. But there's also a fake nurse who's been jailed 22 months for impersonation and forgery. First of all, this person was training, was at the nursing and midwifery training college, but was sacked. This training college in the Western region, but was sacked. And then he decided to allegedly forge documents so he could do national service. And details of that is captured here. It's been found out and jailed. Okay, well, not allegedly. The person's been jailed, so guilty of the offense. So that's the story on page 3 in the Times.
Okay. Have you got one?
Yeah, I wanted to look at the subject of the interest rates. It was an issue raised yesterday in Parliament by Kennedy Ejiofor, and it also just dovetails into the whole conversation we've been having about how the Bank of Ghana seems to give a certain rate, and the banks really don't tend to
follow
the rate and make credit accessible to the private sector or whoever wants to borrow. And I think that it's well within that, because of the way we do business in Ghana, for example, you can't trace people. You can't know whether the address they gave you is right. And those are some of the excuses that they tend to give. They say, there's so much risk if I have to borrow. So if I don't mark up and so increase it incrementally, then I'm going to lose. But at the end of the day, we have to think about maybe the small startup that would need that sort of money to take the business to the next level. I wish that the bank could do better and try and heed to the advice that has always been around, even before Kenny Japon, the Member of Parliament, is saying this.
You mean the central bank?
Not the central, but the commercial
banks. The banks.
Because the central bank gives realistic rates,
and
the bank are supposed to comply, but then they give variant differences as to why they can't.
I think there's work to be done by everyone. The government needs to step up, setting up the environment that allows for banks to have a bit more confidence in lending, creating the national identification system and the addressing system, and making sure that they work and they are every Ghanaian is compliant, so that banks can have some comfort.
Oh, that's true. That's true.
Shall I touch on this real quick? Ajay refutes architect's allegation, says firm is doing legitimate business. David Ajay, of course, you know, he's been at the center of so many complaints and petitions and so forth, because apparently there are 12 contracts that were announced or listed on his website, Ghanaian contracts.
All in his name.
All in the name of his company.
Okay.
For some reason, somebody doesn't understand this. Now, I would like to express my personal view on this. Am I allowed? Am I permitted to express my personal view on this? Thank you. Okay, I'll start with a controversial statement, then I'll explain myself. If I had my way, every state building would be designed by David Ejiofor.
Too much.
If I had my way.
Yeah.
Now,
your statement is not controversial at all, actually.
Now, let me explain. The government is one customer in Ghana. One customer. It's the government, yes, but it's one customer. You are a customer. You are a customer. I'm a customer. We all design buildings. We all build. So architects, it's not like without government contract, they don't have work. Government is one customer. And that customer has chosen David Ajay. Now, you might ask questions about the process by which he was chosen. And it's fair to ask those questions because we have laws, right? But at the same time, architecture, much as it's a science, it also has an art component to it. You are designing things that don't exist. You are going for artistic value. And when you are procuring art, it's different from when you are procuring a piece of machinery. For a machinery, you can give specifications. It must be this, it must be that, it must be that. For art, there is a limit to your specifications. So you say, okay, you have I have acreage of this much. I need to build something that is 400 capacity or whatever. That's the specification. The rest of it is art. Everybody will come up with their design. Then you look at it and say, this one, I like it. So it's not about this one is value for money or this one is... yes, of course, you have to consider those things for the specified aspect of it. But in the end, you will choose what you think is most aesthetically appealing, what represents the ethos of the organization that you are building for, and so forth. So those are qualitative decisions, not quantitative. So if somebody then writes and complains that it's not fair, then this is the one I like, and you say it's not fair.
I think one of the concerns, what I read from one of the, there was a company, something consortium, was the fact that they had been given the contracts already.
Yes. Especially for the Marine Drive
process. For the Marine, they had gone through the process. And they were told that Sir David was coming to help out, something of a sort.
Right.
Only to find out that they had actually negotiated with him to take over.
So you see?
So there seemed to be, at least on the surface of it, with the complaints coming in, that there are some procedural issues. Because if you give me a contract and you suddenly take it away from me and give it to someone else when I've been working on it for all this while, then there's an issue.
So you see, I get that. And if that particular, the consortium or whatever, wishes to sue for judgment debt, that will then be up to a court to decide whether indeed... That will be up to a court to decide whether indeed some processes were breached. But in the end, the government is still a customer. So if I hire you as a carpenter and I decide I no longer want to work with you,
Charlie,
and I hire a new carpenter... I think it should be allowed, as long as I make sure I don't leave you out of pocket.
Well, looking at all the designs and the acclamations he's gotten all around the world, the way he's futuristic in his designs, I love him. I don't care whether we abandon all our...
We have all the engineers
in Ghana. We still have a lot of flooding and all the issues. They've not been resolved.
We'll have to come and work in Ghana. The conversation really today is the finals of the Africa Cup of Nations. Is Algeria seeking to get a second time cap, and Senegal, who are hoping that they can get their first Africa Cup. And that's the I am rooting for Senegal, really. Stay with us for details of sports coming up right after this.